When a plane is in trouble and the oxygen masks drop, you're instructed to put your own mask on first before helping others put theirs on. And the reason why is because if you help others who are struggling first, you'll both pass out. Whereas if you put your own mask on first, then help the other person, you'll be conscious at the very least and be able to help them. And this highlights the difference between two philosophical concepts. Altruism, which is the idea that we should all help each other first before ourselves, and then the idea of self-interest, which is that we should take responsibility for our own lives first before we help other people. It's a question of priorities. If you're struggling to eat, you obviously can't give to charity. You know, you can only give to others if you have something to give, which means you have to look after your own self-interest first, accumulate wealth, and only then can you give it away. In other words, you can only help other people after you've helped yourself. And the reason why I bring this up is because altruism is the beating heart of National Socialism. People are drawn to Hitler and the Nazis because they promised to look after those within the group. The Germans, the Aryans, the people, the Volk.
In the German language, we have a word which admirably expresses this underlying spirit of all work. It is Pflichtverfügung, which means the service of the common weal before the consideration of one's own interests. The fundamental spirit out of which this kind of activity springs is the contrast distinction of egotism, and we call it idealism. By this we mean to signify the willingness of the individual to make sacrifices for the community and his fellow men.
As Hitler demonstrates, the idea of self-interest has a bad rep, and the reason why is because it's been under consistent attack for millennia. When you type in the definition of self-interest, you get told it means regard for one's own interest or advantage, especially with disregard for others. So it's not that you look after yourself first before helping others, it's that you must disregard others entirely. When asking for the synonyms of self-interest, you'll find words like selfishness, self-absorption, egomania, narcissism, and many more like that. Generally, it's all negative. In contrast, altruism is paired with words like benevolence, humanitarianism, kindness, charity, generosity, and so on. Really positive words overall. And this isn't a coincidence. The powers that be want you to put their interests first, rather than your own. And the best way to do that is to destroy yourself, by shaming you and guilting you into not putting yourself first, and annihilating the idea that you are an individual. You become an unthinking zombie. At that point, they can convince you to help others, them, by contributing to society, the state, which they just so happen to control. In other words, you're manipulated into giving your wealth and resources to those that enslave you.
The man who named the creed is the philosopher Auguste Comte. The name he coined is altruism. The medieval adoration of God, says Comte, must now be transmuted into the adoration of a new divinity, the goddess humanity. Sacrifice for the sake of the Lord is outdated. It must give way fully to sacrifice for the sake of others. And this time, Comte says, man must really be selfless. As soon as the spirit of egotism begins to prevail among the people, then the bonds of the social order break, and man, by seeking his own personal happiness, veritably tumbles out of heaven and falls into hell. Posterity will not remember those who pursued only their own individual interests, but it will praise those heroes who renounced their own happiness. The Jew offers the most striking contrast to the Aryan. There is probably no other people in the world who have so developed the instinct of self-preservation as the so-called chosen people.
National Socialism is altruism made manifest. While the Jews were portrayed as selfish devils who were greedy, lustful, and sinful creatures, they represented the self, the person who places themselves before others.
Thus, I finally discovered who were the evil spirits leading our people astray.
But of course, it's not enough for you to just care about other people at random. You need to be controlled, and the best way to control you, like a puppet, is to destroy yourself and give you a group identity, a unifying force or idea. Well, Hitler brings up the concept of this idea, and sometimes he calls it the national idea or the folk idea, but when he says it, he means that everyone must bow down to this unifying force. And this concept comes from Marx, who's getting it from Hegel, who's getting it from Plato, and a guy called Heraclitus. And there's loads of other philosophers in between. We can trace the inheritance of this concept right back to the dawn of the written word. And just to confirm this, Hans Gunther, the race pope, devoted an entire book to Plato. Alfred Rosenberg also praised Plato because he wanted to save his people on a racial basis. I'm not a pagan, and I'm not promoting paganism. However, the pagans had a perspective of the world that we've lost today, and that perspective can help us understand what's going on here. So, for a pagan, everything and every belief has a spirit, or God. And by the way, the spirit is the God, and the God is the spirit, it's the same thing. But if we list off some of the old gods, we have the god of thunder, we have the god of the sea, we've got the god of the hearth and the home, the god of the cat, the god of the cauldron, and numerous other physical objects or real things. But we also have the god of love, we have the god of skills, we have the goddess of liminal spaces, Hecate. She's the goddess of the backrooms, by the way. Maybe she's the entity watching you as you get lost in a maze of mono-yellow walls and moist carpet. Anyway, the point is that every object or belief has its own spirit, or its own god. And it's, you know, so as a pagan, you get to decide which gods you worship. Do you worship the god of love? Do you worship the god of the roads? Do you make sacrifices to the god of the heavens? You get to decide what you prioritize. But also, it allows us to conceive of the world as multiple separate things or concepts. And to give you an example of this, I want you to go outside and physically place your hand on society. As in, you know, like I'm putting my hand on my shirt, I want you to go outside and place your hand on society. Well, what are you going to put your hand on? You can put your hand on a road, that's not society. You can put your hand on other people, but they're not society, they're individuals. It turns out that there is no society. It doesn't exist. It doesn't physically exist. It's a spiritual concept. And thus, the idea of society, goddess society with a capital S, is a god. It's a religious belief. This is why the ancient Greeks had a goddess for the polis, the city, Athena. Because the city, the society, the polis, none of these things really existed. You cannot place your hand on a city, because a city is not a physical thing. It's a collection of individual buildings and roads. And so, in order for us to name it a city or society, we must create the belief that these things are actual entities. So we actualize them into existence as gods, hence Athena, or Lady Liberty, or Britannia. And this is where Plato comes along and says that there are two dimensions. The physical, material world, which we can touch and feel, and then we have the spiritual realm of non-material perfection. And he says that these abstract, non-material things are supernatural entities. They are forms, things in and of themselves. They are gods. So society isn't just a perception or a name for a group activity. It's actually a god in and of itself. But also in Plato's mind, these forms are the spirit that binds us all together. So we're connected, not through individual action, in fact he says we're not capable of operating independently, but that we're connected by and operate for these spiritual entities known as forms. we operate for goddess society, we operate for goddess nation, we operate for goddess gender or goddess class or goddess state. And he says we must sacrifice everything for these gods, including ourself.
What follows in regard to human action, according to Plato, is a life of self-sacrificial service. When men gather in society, says Plato, the unit of reality and the standard of value is the community as a whole. Each man, therefore, must strive, as far as he can, to wipe out his own individuality, his personal desires, ambitions, etc., and merge himself into the community, becoming one with it and living only to serve its welfare. On this view, the collective is not an aggregate, but an entity. Society, the state, is regarded as a living organism. This is the so-called organic theory of the state, and the individual becomes merely a cell of this organism's body, with no more rights or privileges than belong to any such cell.
Leonard Peikoff goes on to explain how Plato is the source of mysticism and collectivism in the West, although we do now know who Plato was influenced by. And by the way, in the previous videos I've made on the religion of National Socialism and Hitler's Gnosticism, a few of you recommended me this book, and I just want to thank you all, you know, for doing that, because this book is absolutely brilliant. It's only about 300 pages, but I've made 67 pages worth of notes, quotes, and references from this book. Every sentence is like a paragraph. There's so much in here, and I can't possibly explain it all, but I would say that if you're interested in understanding the cause of Hitler's Germany and the origins of the ideas behind it, this should be top priority on your reading list. And this isn't a sponsored video. I'm genuinely one, you know, it is genuinely one of the best books that I've ever read. And I'll be honest, it's hit me like a freight train. It's made me finally pull the plug and read Ayn Rand, who wrote the introduction. I've never actually read her before, but I was so impressed by her intro that, you know, and what Peikoff was saying, that, you know, I've started reading her as well. And I would say that this book has come at a good time for me in general, because I'm immersed in these subjects all day and night, and it does feel like I'm under psychological attack by these ideologies, Marxism, fascism, Nazism. And there's other reasons too, but I don't want to bog this video down about that. Nonetheless, I think if you're watching this video and you're interested in what I'm talking about here, this should be a high priority read. Before Plato, though, there was another ancient Greek called Heraclitus. Plato was influenced by Heraclitus, as were the Nazis, and there is a book called National Socialism, Its Principles and Philosophy by Carlos Videla that, you know, it basically swoons over Heraclitus. I could be wrong, but I get the impression that Videla is an actual Nazi, or a third position of some kind. And if he isn't, then he certainly needs to rewrite the book, because that's the impression his writing gives. So, you know, and that's also why I'm not necessarily recommending this book, although you can read it if you want to. Nonetheless, Videla explains that Hitler's most important belief was the law of struggle, Kampfgesetz. And by this he means a struggle between different social groups, not individuals. And because of this law, Hitler believed that there was no life without struggle, and that the world is in perpetual struggle between different groups. Hitler described struggle as the father of all things, which Videla says was inspired by Heraclitus, who said that war was the father of all things.
In this sense, the National Socialist worldview was heir of the Indo-European thoughts of Heraclitus and his world of perpetual strife, called Polemos. In this worldview, the union of all entities in the universe formed a chaotic and undifferentiated mass called Hen, the One. In other words, the gatherer of everything. Hen was pure existence, a shapeless being. It was a seeming chaos, an undifferentiated mass. Only the struggle, Polemos, allowed individual beings to be extracted from that undifferentiated chaos.
Does this sound like Gnosticism to you? Because it certainly sounds like it to me. And it's been debated whether Heraclitus was influenced by Zoroastrianism, however you say it, which was Gnosticism. They influenced the Manichaeans, who influenced the Cathars. And for those of you who didn't see my recent video on the real religion behind National Socialism, I'll give you a quick synopsis. Gnostics believe that the Christian God that made the material world is actually the devil, or the demiurge, and that there's a true God who's above and behind the Christian God. This demiurge has trapped our souls in this realm, so our bodies are our prisons, and the true God is not material. And thus, the believers in the true God, the Gnostics, want to transcend the material realm, which will free us from our bodies, and allow our souls to become one with the true God. The beliefs of Heraclitus sound extremely similar to that.
For Nietzsche and the Nazis, an abyss was irremediably opened at the dawn of the West with the philosophy of Socrates, and later with the Platonic myth of the cave, the myth of a new being for Western Indo-Europeans. Plato constructed an analogy where the life of man on Earth was equivalent to living inside a cave. The inhabitants of the interior of the Platonic cave perceived shadows projected onto the inner wall by outer beings. Among these shadows, the caven dwellers built their own idea of reality. In this analogy, the natural world, corresponding to the interior of the cave, representing transcendent and perennial ideas, the real essence of those illusionary shadows. The ideal emerged in that moment as a new truth outside of nature. In this myth, man and the world became only illusionary shadows of something real. The father of all things was thought of from that moment on as a transmundane entity, perfect, without error or defeat. The essence of beings became an ideal, an eternal and moral archetype, good and perfect in itself. Metaphysical essence was thought immobile, unchangeable, incapable of fighting, a conservative entity that was largely unattainable, as well as transcendent, alien, and improper to man.
People have argued with me that it wasn't Gnosticism, but you can see why I'm aiming in that direction, because Gnosticism, maybe Hermeticism, fits really well. But that's a debate for another day. For now, it's from Heraclitus that Plato gets his idea of the forms, which is the spirit that unites us all together.
Only the struggle, polemos, allowed individual beings to be extracted from that undifferentiated chaos, hence the diversity of the world. This is what the Greeks called panta, or the many. According to the pre-Western thinkers, struggle was common to all beings, and it was considered the essence of the universe, that which modern philosophers call being. That is the reason why Heraclitean thought considered a shapeless existence hen, the one, as having the same existential essence as panta, the many forms. For Heraclitus, a dualism did not exist between the essence of beings and their appearance, or between gods and nature. In that sense, struggle allowed man to exist and also to preserve his existence. As stated by the ancient Greeks, polemos belongs to us, since we ourselves are conflict.
So, just to clarify that, he's saying that we are struggle itself. And in this struggle in ourselves, we are closer to God, the shapeless existence. The word struggle is just another word for the Holy Spirit. So in other words, when Hitler uses the word struggle, which he does a lot, he really means the spirit of God that binds us together. And it gets even crazier. Heraclitus influences Plato, who influences everybody, basically, throughout the medieval period, including Saint Augustine. So according to Ayn Rand and Leonard Peikoff, this explains why there was so much mysticism in medieval times. Then Thomas Aquinas rediscovered Aristotle in the 13th century, and Aristotle stood for reason and logic, and thus was mostly against mysticism. Therefore, Aristotle's rediscovery resulted in the Renaissance and the decline of mysticism. Concerned by this development, Immanuel Kant, who was an incredibly influential German philosopher and theologian, wanted to save religion from science, and did this by reviving Platonism and the ideas of Heraclitus. Kant said that man's mind automatically and subjectively distorts the evidence before it. Thus, reality is nothing more than a creation of man's consciousness. Reality, therefore, isn't real. It's only what it appears to man. Thus, there are two dimensions again, true reality, which is spiritual, and the unreal material world. Where have we heard this before? Kant said that logic was merely a subjective human device and thus has no basis in reality, and that science is limited to the material realm, not the spiritual one. And thus, faith is the only means of accessing the true reality. Therefore, mystic fantasy, also known as Romanticism, was born.
I have, therefore, found it necessary to deny knowledge in order to make room for faith.
One of Kant's heirs was Hegel, and from Hegel we get Marx, who studied and wrote his own work on Hegel's The Philosophy of Religion. But from Hegel we also get Giovanni Gentile, the philosophical founder of fascism. Gentile's Origins and Doctrines of Fascism is dripping with Hegelianism. He refers to the state as a spiritual creation of the people, and he's getting this idea directly from Hegel.
The state is therefore the basis and center of all the concrete elements in the life of a people, of art, law, morals, religion, and science. The substance that exists in that concrete reality, which is the state, is the spirit of the people itself. The actual state is animated by this spirit in all its particular affairs, in its wars, institutions, etc. Everything in the state, nothing outside the state, nothing against the state. The very essence of spirit is activity. It actualizes its potentiality and makes itself its own deed, its own work. Thus, it is with the spirit of a nation. It is a spirit having strictly defined characteristics which exist and persist in the events and transitions that make up its history. That is its work. That is what this particular nation is. Nations are what their deeds are. The fascist state, therefore, as distinct from the nationalistic state, is an entirely spiritual creation. It is a national state because, from the point of view of fascism, it is the result of spiritual action rather than a presupposition.
When the Marxists say that fascism is not socialism, they're wrong. Fascism rejects Marxism and goes back to the original source, Hegel, and says what Hegel says. In fact, Hegel has more in common with Giovanni Gentile than he does with Karl Marx.
The state is the divine idea as it exists on earth. The march of God in the world, that is what the state is. In the existence of a nation, the substantial aim is to be a state and preserve itself as such. A nation that has not formed itself into a state, a mere nation, has, strictly speaking, no history, like the nations which existed in a condition of savagery. What happens to a nation has its essential significance in relation to the state.
That sounds like Nazism and fascism to me, not Marxism. And what did Hitler say? Nations are created by the purity of the blood, and if the blood of the nation is corrupted, then the nation will fall. Where did he get this idea from? He got it from Hegel. Hegel just said it, and he says it elsewhere as well. Now, Hitler may not have got it directly from Hegel, maybe he got it from someone else who had read Hegel, but the point is that the idea originates from Hegel. And so, the philosophical origin of Marxism, National Socialism, and Fascism is Hegel, who's getting his ideas from Kant, who's looking at Saint Augustine and Plato and Heraclitus, and probably also Gnosticism as well. We have the lineage mapped out clearly. These ideologies are different denominations of the same religion. They hate each other, not because they're different, but because they're competing on the same ground. Catholics and Protestants are both Christians, but wars have been fought between the two groups for various reasons. And it's the same with the modern religions too. And as a side note, Videla talks at length about how the Nazis were inspired by Heraclitus and Plato, but he just so happens to skip over Kant, Hegel, and everyone else in between. Gee, I wonder why. Is it because he wants to pretend that Nazism doesn't share the same ideological roots as Marxism? Yeah, I think that's the reason why, isn't it? But it gets even crazier. So, Hegel borrows Plato's essence or forms idea, and then transforms it into the idea that it's the spirit of the people itself. Marx then replaced Hegel's spirit with economic matter and material as the essence that unites the various classes. Well, it turns out that he wasn't the only one to do something like this. I've been joking for years now about how the Aryan Super Saiyans all had the magic blood. And I've explained that they believed that only the magic blood can create nations. Hitler literally says this in Mein Kampf. If they make the blood pure, then the Aryans can live for 1,000 years in a heaven on earth, a Third Reich, which represents the three stages of history as outlined by Gnostics from Joachim of Flora onwards. And if they fail to keep the blood pure, if the magic blood is corrupted by the bad blood of the Jews, they say that this will be the end and downfall of civilization. Well, even though I'd been explaining this magic blood thing for years, what I didn't realise was just how correct I actually was. They do genuinely believe that the blood is magic, because, as Karl Popper and Leonard Peikoff point out, the Nazis replaced Hegel's spirit with the term blood. The blood is the spirit, and the spirit is the blood. They said that your blood is your soul. So when the Nazis say they're trying to purify the blood, what they really mean is that they're trying to purify the spirit, or soul, of the people, the race, or the nation. And the blood of the nation is the spirit of the nation, and the spirit, or the blood, unites them in the nation.
The modern myth of blood and soil has its exact counterpart in Plato's myth of the earthborn. Nevertheless, not Hegel plus Plato, but Hegel plus Heichel is the formula of modern racialism. As we shall see, Marx replaced Hegel's spirit by matter and by material and economic interests. In the same way, racialism substitutes for Hegel's spirit something material, the quasi-biological conception of blood or race. Instead of spirit, blood is the self-developing essence. Instead of spirit, blood is the sovereign of the world, and displays itself on the stage of history. And instead of its spirit, the blood of a nation determines its essential destiny. The transubstantiation of Hegelianism into racialism, or of spirit into blood, does not greatly alter the main tendency of Hegelianism. It only gives it a tinge of biology and of modern evolutionism. The outcome is a materialistic and at the same time mystical religion of a self-developing biological essence, very closely reminiscent of the religion of creative evolution whose prophet was the Hegelian Bergson.
When I told my friend that the blood is the spirit and the spirit is the blood, his eyes widened because it's a revelation in itself. And I know it's so obviously correct. Like, I hadn't realized it, and nobody had pointed it out to me. But when I read it, I was like, of course it is. You know, of course it is. You know, it's been staring us in the face this whole time. And this just confirms to me that National Socialism isn't scientific in the slightest. What they were doing was fighting a religious war. The whole essence of National Socialism, from start to finish, the whole of the Second World War, especially in the East, is a religious conflict between denominations of mysticism. National Socialism may or may not have been Gnosticism, that's up for debate, but it's clearly a religion, and Marxism is Gnosticism as well, so we have two religions, two Weltanschauungs, fighting each other for domination, with the Marxists becoming the winner in the end. I've barely dipped my toe in the water today, and I could go much deeper, but I want to see what you guys think first. Have I overwhelmed you with too much information? Do you want me to go any deeper, or go over any of the concepts I've mentioned in more detail? Or has this been enough for you? Let me know what you guys think below, and I'll decide what's best. But I'm really enjoying this topic, and I'm more than happy to go as in-depth as you guys want on this. So, you know, I'm looking for more books on the topic. So give me your recommendations if you have any. And in the meantime, if you haven't seen my other videos on the Nazi religion, I'll leave the links everywhere. Thanks for watching. Bye for now.